Let's pray again. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, once again, thank you so much for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity again to worship you, to learn from you, especially, Lord, to be transformed and have that encounter with you. Help us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, how are you? Okay. So last night, we did not see most of you here. So we miss you last night. Okay. So our topic actually last night is about Kingdom of Heaven. And if you were not able to hear our topic last night, we're inviting you to like our video in Facebook. I don't know if you can have the access with the video. You just subscribe to Sir Winelfredo. Sa akin na lang po, sa timeline ko. Yun. You can go to my timeline and watch the video. So if you missed the last night's topic, you can watch it online. No, so we are inviting as well those who are going to watch online to follow us, and we're excited to hear your testimonies after the encounter with these 2 weeks. Okay, so tonight I'll be sharing to you another special topic or interesting topic, and of course this is also an encounter in the Bible, and hopefully after this we will have another encounter with Jesus. No. Before that, so as I used to tell you, I would like to share a story. Who among you here have experienced already doing something and you don't know that that something will have an impact to your community or to your friends? Like for example, you share a food or you share something and your motivation is just to share that, but later on, you did not realize that that something will give an impact to many people. Have you experienced that? I don't know if you get my question or my statement, but in my case, I experienced that. How many here have heard the Send Ministry? Okay, I think a lot of you here heard that because one of our members is staying here, Monique, and she is the one who is in charge in folding the trucks. So our ministry actually is about trucks, no? I want to tell you the background of Send Ministry. The Send Ministry is actually came from a canvassing group of Bulacan, and we had our canvassing work in Bulacan for 4 months. Now, after that, because of course, the purpose of canvassing work is for us to be exposed outside in the field through canvassing work and through selling books. And after the ministry for 4 months, we talked with each other and we asked each one of the members, what will we do next after these 4 months? No, after going back to school, so does it mean that our ministry in SEND or our ministry in canvassing will be done already? So we're asking each one of us in the group what will be our plans. So what happened is we organized our team, we elected officers, and that time, I don't know if you know Kuya Ryan, he was the president that time, and we planned particular plans, but we don't know that those plans will give an impact. So to make the long story short, our group actually is just organized for the sake of continuing the work of canvassing. And we don't have any idea that our group will become a track society. So after several months, someone asked a help from us, And he told us, he wants us to make a track, a pamphlet. And the title of that is, Ang Nakalimutang Payo ng Pagkain. Payo sa pagkain. Payo sa pagkain, okay? So, we were challenged to do that. So for I think 2 months, we are making the tracks, we're editing it. And after doing that, we printed it for, I think that was 16,000. We were able to print for 16,000 copies. And we sent it to PYC, Philippine Youth for Christ. Then after that, what we all know is that we will just do the track for that moment. Unknowingly, God is leading us to become a real track society. And you know what happened now? We were already given 160,000 tracks throughout the whole Philippines. And actually, we can't imagine it that our tracks now is being read by the people coming from Mindanao. And just last month, someone contacted us and we sent some tracks to Mindanao. And also in Baguio. So my point here, there are things in our life and there are events and situations in our life that most of the times we thought that we will just do it for that moment, and we actually do not have any idea that those things that we are doing will give an impact to people. Tonight, I would like to give to you a story that actually this person doesn't have any idea that his life would give an impact to someone. And not only to someone, but actually to the whole world. And this person is the reason why this world, why you and I right now are experiencing the freedom of religion. And he was used by God to turn this world upside down. I'm talking about a person named Andrew. Who among you here knows Andrew? None, right? If I'll be asking you, how many of you here knows Peter? Peter, the fisherman. Not your classmate. If I'd be asking you to tell stories about Peter, I believe you can tell us a lot of stories about him, right? You can tell more than 5 stories. His encounter with Jesus. What more? His betrayal of Jesus Christ when he denied Jesus Christ. Walking on the sea, on the water. What more? Washing of the feet, foot washing. In the resurrection of Jesus Christ, there are a lot of stories about Peter. And actually, more than the stories in the Gospels, we can still find Peter in the book of Acts, in the book of Corinthians, and even in his own book, 1 and 2 Peter. So there are a lot of stories about Peter, but there is this someone who was seldom known by people, because actually, there are only few stories about him. The name of this person is Andrew, and I would like to introduce you to him tonight, and we will be learning something about him. The title of our series or topic this evening, Little is Much. And can be found in John chapter 1, verse 35 to 42. Let's start the story. John chapter 1, verse 35. The text says, the next day again, John was standing with 2 of his disciples. 36, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, behold, the Lamb of God. So the message of John is very simple. He told his disciples, he told the people, behold, look, the Lamb of God. And he's referring to Jesus Christ. And in verse 37 says, next verse, the two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. So now this is very interesting because despite of the simplicity of the message of John, just three words, behold the Lamb of God, four words. Behold the Lamb of God. And with those words, those two disciples who heard him saying those words, follow Jesus Christ. And what happened next, in verse 38, Jesus turned. So take note of these words. Jesus turned. So maybe Jesus is just walking beside the Jordan River and John is telling them, behold the Lamb of God. And as Jesus passed by the Jordan River and as he is walking beside the river, the two disciples followed him. And what happened, Jesus turned, looking at them, asking them, what are you seeking? Come on, Jesus. You have now the fruit of your ministry. For the first time, you will be having the first fruit of your ministry, two disciples. But now Jesus is asking them, what are you seeking? And they said to him, Rabbi, where are you staying? Interestingly. And he said to them, come and you will see. The Bible did not explain what is the situation of the home, or we don't know what exactly the place where Jesus brought them to be with him and stay with him. But what we know, after staying with Jesus, after Jesus telling them, come and see and stay with me, so they came and saw where he was staying, and they stayed with him that day, for it was about the tenor. And now this is the impact. After staying with Jesus, this what happened next. Verse 40, one of the two who heard John speak and followed Jesus was who? Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. Now, after staying with Jesus and hearing Jesus, and after knowing where Jesus is staying, Andrew followed him, and this is what Andrew did next. He first found his own brother Simon and said to him, brother, I have found the Messiah. I have found the Messiah. And I don't know what is the reaction of Andrew that time, but I believe his reaction, his countenance, his face brought Peter into excitement. And what happened after telling Peter, after telling Simon that he had found the Messiah, he brought him to Jesus. And Jesus, looking unto Peter, said, you are Simon, the son of John. From now on, you will be called Cephas, which means stone or Peter. Now, Brother Dominic, what's the point? In four Gospels, you can only find Andrew three times. Though you can find his name a lot of times, but you can only find his name with a specific story three times. It can be found in John chapter 1, John chapter 6, and John chapter 12. Interestingly, whenever you find the word Andrew, it is always in connection with the name Simon Peter's brother. What's the point? It's because most of the people right now, even in their time and even right now, most of us know a lot of stories about Peter, right? And so because we know a lot of stories about Peter and we seldom hear about the story of Andrew, John needs to associate the name of Andrew with the name of Peter just to tell them that Andrew is the brother of Peter. To give you an example, like for example, I am, I am, I am not known by people. But I am, let's say, the son of the president. So for me to be recognized, people will tell you, he is Dominic, the son of the president. Are you getting the point? So meaning to say, for the reader of the Bible recognize Andrew as a very important person, John needs to associate him with his brother named Simon. Now, what's the point? Sisters, Andrew is a very interesting character in the Bible. Why? Because whenever you find Andrew, he always brings people to Christ. And the very first person he was able to bring at the feet of Jesus is no other than his own brother, Simon. And you know what? Just only one person. Andrew doesn't know that his brother will become popular now. For Andrew, his only task is to reveal and to tell to Peter that he was able to find the Messiah, and that Messiah changed his life. And after that encounter, he brought Peter to Jesus and telling Peter, I have found the Messiah. I want you to know him as well. I want you to have that joy also with him. And you know what happened? In the book of Acts, we can find Peter, someone who is bringing thousands of people to Jesus Christ. But we don't know that person who brought this world upside down was also brought by someone no other than his own brother. First point, we have 3 points again, 3 observations, and we're done. First observation. Friends, we might have talents. Not might, we all have talents. That is sure. We all have talents. God wants us to use the talents in whatever ways. We don't know how will it impact people, but God is just telling us, use that talent. It might be in the form of money. It might be in the form of singing. It might be in the form of help. It might be in the form of speaking. It might be in the form of inviting people. In whatever ways, God gave us talent and He wants us to use those talents. And like Andrew, God gave those talents because He wants to reveal in this world that we care for people. Andrew cares for his brother. And that's the reason why he brought Peter to Jesus Christ. Friends, don't waste your talent. Don't waste your capabilities, your abilities. Don't waste your money to something that will not give an impact to this world. Use everything that you have for His glory, because we don't know. Someday, there will be a person coming to you and he or she will tell you, you know what, brother, you know what, sister? If not because of that talent, I will not be at the feet of Jesus Christ. At the feet of Jesus Christ. Second observation. After this, Jesus went away. John chapter 6, second story about Andrew. Other side of the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Verse 2. And a large crowd was following him because they saw the signs that he was doing on the sick. Verse 3. Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. Verse 4, now the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was at hand. Verse 5, lifting up his eyes then, and seeing that a large crowd was coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat. Remember the story of the 5,000? And actually, there are not only 5,000. Some scholars says that they might be coming from, they might be ranging from 15 to 20,000, because the 5,000 here are only men. Now, I don't know, but in the other gospel, the author is telling that Jesus had that compassion to people. Jesus saw them hungering, not only for food, but they are hungering for Him. But of course, Jesus is not only concerned about their spiritual need, but He is also concerned about their physical need. And so, having that compassion with them, Jesus told His one of disciples named Philip, "Philip, where can we buy food? What shall we do next?" But you know, Jesus knows everything. Right? He knows what to do. But He told Philip, He asked Philip, not because Jesus doesn't know what to do, but in the next verse says, He said this to test Him, for He Himself knew what He would do. Jesus knows it very well that Philip is one of the disciples who had this little faith. And that's why whenever I use my name Philip, I'm always being reminded of my being a doubtful person. And actually, I used to doubt God. That's my tendency. And I can relate with Philip because my name is also Philip. So now the Bible is telling us that Jesus, the reason of Jesus asking him is just to test him. And what happened next in verse 7, Philip answered him, "Lord, we don't have enough money. I don't know what to do next. I don't know, Lord. How can we let these people eat?" But there is this someone coming to Jesus, having that boldness and having that faith, telling Jesus Christ, "Lord," one of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "Lord, there is a lad here. There is a boy here. He has 2 fish and 5 loaves. Lord, I don't know how can this boy, help us to feed this 5,000. But I know, Lord, I have faith on you that you can do something great today." Second observation, friend, God gave us talents because He would like us to reveal in this world, that we have faith on Him. How many times that we doubted God, I myself, how many times I doubted God, "Lord, how can I give an impact to people with this kind of talent? Lord, I don't know how to speak. Lord, I don't know how to deal with people." But Jesus is telling me, "Just trust me. Just trust me, Dominic. Just have faith on me. And by doing so, you will reveal to this world that your talent shows your faith on Him, on me. Shows your faith on me." Third observation. Now among those who went up to worship at the feast were some Greeks. Verse 21. So this came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and asked him, "Sir," remember this Philip, the doubtful, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." So they asked Philip, the Greeks, "Philip, sir, we want to see Jesus Christ. Where is He?" Philip doesn't know what to do, but he knows that there is this someone. When he doubted, Jesus came boldly, bringing a lad to him and shows his faith on Jesus. He knows Andrew very well, and that's why what happened in verse 22, next verse, Okay? Philip went and told who? Andrew. Philip can just bring the Greeks to Jesus Christ. But I believe that time, Philip again doesn't know what to do. I don't know how can I accommodate these people. So, because he knows Andrew very well, what he did, instead of just bringing the Greeks to Jesus Christ, he brought those Greeks to Andrew and asking Andrew, what shall we do? And Andrew telling him, friend, let's just bring them to Jesus. And Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Third observation, the talent, the ability, the little ability that Andrew has that time reveals his integrity. Reveals his integrity. I would like to appeal to you this evening. The message is just simple. You have talents. Each one of us here, we're given the chance to be a steward. We were given the chance to exercise a responsibility. We were given the chance to exercise and, you know, show up our talents, our skills. It's only in our hands now to reveal our care for others, our faith in God, and our own integrity. It might be about tithes. It might be about your health. It might be about time. It might be about what more? It might be about truth. It might be about environment. It might be about people, relationship, money. In whatever ways God is telling us right now, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2, God is calling us to be a faithful steward. Friend, don't waste your talent. Don't waste your time. Don't waste your money. Little is much when God is in it. We don't know how will it impact the world, but someday soon, you just don't know how that talent will be used by God for His own glory. Little is much when God is in it. Let's pray. Oh, Father God in heaven, thank you once again for your faithfulness. Thank you, Lord, for calling us to reflect that faithfulness as well to others. And right now, Lord, like Andrew, you are calling us to use our talent no matter how much is it, no matter how little is it, you're calling us to use it for your glory, to show our care, our faith, and our integrity. Lord, take our life and let it be. Use it for your glory, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.